In this Q&A video, we're going to answer the question, are we allowed to install two voltages or two circuits in one electrical enclosure? In a previous video, we saw Gary demonstrating the installation efficiencies that can be created by using the Variabox by CEENorm to provide a three-phase, single-phase and 110-volt supply all within the same practical and convenient electrical accessory. In the video, it can be seen that the Variabox has a 110-volt and 400-volt supply from two different circuits. This could quite feasibly lead to danger when opening up the Variabox for testing or maintenance purposes if suitable precautions are not taken. In this video, we will address the common misunderstandings around whether this practice is actually permitted by BS 7671, what the dangers are, and attempt to answer the question about what BS 7671 deems as suitable precautions when multiple circuits are installed within a single accessory. There can often be confusion as to whether or not BS 7671 actually permits the presence of multiple circuits within a single accessory. This misconception can be understood when looking at division of installation under paragraph 314, so let's have a look at it here. Looking at selected points within this paragraph, we can see that installation shall be divided into circuits to avoid danger, facilitate safe inspection, testing and maintenance, and prevent the indirect energising of a circuit intended to be isolated. Upon first review of the wording within this section, it could be assumed that BS 7671 seems to suggest separation of all final circuits from one another, which in essence could potentially restrict the wiring of two circuits within a single accessory. By installing multiple circuits within a single accessory, this could be seen to contravene paragraph 314.1 indent 1 by potentially increasing danger, and respectively indent 2, in potentially creating an unsafe situation in terms of inspection, testing and maintenance, which also goes against indent 6 and paragraph 314.4 by complicating considerations for isolation purposes. So, from a first read of this particular section of BS 7671, it could appear pretty solidly in favour of separation of individual final circuits from one another. However, interestingly, in Chapter 35, for example, the requirement for multiple power supplies is recognised in consideration of safety services and continuity of service. Before the recent 18th edition amendments, 710.559 stated that luminaires and lighting installations in medical locations of Group 1 and Group 2, at least two different sources of supply shall be provided. Another example of where BS 7671 recognises multiple sources of supply can be found in Part 5, i.e. paragraph 521.8.3, where two or more circuits are terminated in a single junction box. This shall comply with BSEN 60670-22. This particular standard also recognises other boxes and enclosures. Also, let's not forget the need for multiple supplies within a single accessory or enclosure is seen countless times within industry. There are many examples which require multiple circuits within a single enclosure or accessory, such as lift control panels requiring a three-phase and single-phase supply fed by two separate protective devices at the distribution board. Three-phase, single-phase and 110-volt supplies in workshops, all housed together. Alternative sources of supplies at a distribution board, i.e. PV systems or generator sets. Three-phase contactors with a separate circuit feeding the coil. Lighting in a large commercial office balanced across phases, controlled by a three-gang grid switch. Storage heaters with E7 and 24-hour supply, and so on, and so on. We also need to be mindful of potentially dangerous domestic DIY attempts where multiple circuits may feed a multi-gang switch or grid switch, as well as our old friend borrowed neutrals amongst lighting circuits in particular. So how are we to understand all this seemingly conflicting information? Well, the important thing to keep in mind about paragraph 314 is that it isn't talking about physical separation of two individual circuits from one another in terms of how the circuits are housed, contained or enclosed, which is how part 3 of BS 7671 could have been incorrectly interpreted. The key word here in paragraph 314.4 that is massively significant but could be quite easily overlooked is it reads electrically separate. Simply put here, it is the individual live conductors for each circuit that have to remain continuously separate throughout an entire circuit's termination, rather than physically separate as in a circuit's wiring being specifically housed throughout within separate accessories and/or enclosures. Now, at this point, we could argue about the comparisons between the definitions of enclosure and accessory as defined by BS 7671, where an accessory is defined as a device other than current using equipment associated with such equipment or with the wiring of an installation, and an enclosure, which is defined as a part providing protection of equipment against certain external influences and in any direction providing basic protection. It could be argued that the Varibox is both an accessory and an enclosure. An accessory, as it's a device that allows current using equipment to be plugged into it, utilizing different supplies and protective devices for those individual circuits, but also an enclosure, as it affords basic protection of wiring and IP protection. But maybe we'll save that for another video. Anyhow, we'll jump to 521.8.2, which reinforces the point I made earlier before getting myself sidetracked. The line and neutral conductors of each final circuit shall be electrically separate from those of every other final circuit, so as to prevent the indirect energizing of a final circuit intended to be isolated. Okay, so BS7671 acknowledges the need for multiple circuits within a single accessory, but that does not take away from the fact the installation of multiple circuits within a single accessory does, without question, still give rise to potentially dangerous situations in view of paragraph 314. So what are some of the dangers involved in having multiple circuits within the same enclosure? Well, let's have a look at it. We know that regardless of the number of circuits and nominal voltages contained within them, enclosures and accessories by their design are intended to prevent inadvertent contact with live parts. Paragraph 526.5 of BS7671, for example, requires every joint and termination in a live conductor to be contained in a suitable accessory or equipment enclosure that conforms to appropriate BS product and fire standards. In order to satisfy paragraph 416.2.1 for basic protection, these accessories and enclosures also need to provide a degree of protection for live parts, which is at least IPXXB or IP2X. Furthermore, regulation 416.2.4 states that where it is necessary to remove a barrier or open an enclosure or remove parts of enclosures, this shall be possible only 1) by the use of a key or tool, or 2) after disconnection of the supply to live parts against which the barriers or enclosures afford protection. Gary used the example when critiquing the Varibox of the ease at which a socket outlet and protective device could be swapped over if the client required a different rating. However, to perform this work, the box would have to be opened up, which could give rise to danger if live parts are now accessible. Normally, safe isolation of an accessory would require locating and securing just one source of supply, but what if the person performing this work is not aware of the fact that the accessory is supplied by both a three-phase and 110-volt circuit, and they only isolate one of the circuits supplying the box? That person is now at risk of coming into contact with the other circuit that still remains energized. While 110 volts is unlikely to give a lethal shock to earth, working in the back of the enclosure could get you in contact across the two sides of the live 110 volt supply, which is more than enough to kill. It also goes without saying that direct contact between live three-phase line conductors to earth, or worse still, between line conductors, could very much be fatal. Evidently, the problem we have when multiple circuits are installed within a single accessory is one of safe isolation in direct relation to paragraph 314.1 indent 2, where facilitating safe inspection, testing, and maintenance could become compromised if suitable precautions are not taken to isolate all circuits before opening the box to perform work. We can also refer to the Electricity at Work regulations of 1989 to highlight this point further. Regulation 12 specifically addresses the issue of identifying circuits and disconnecting and securing an accessory for every source of electrical energy. So what's the solution? Firstly, let's address this issue of identifying circuits. And to do this, we can seek clarification from Chapter 5 in BS7671 under 514.10 and 514.11 for warning notices, where we read, every item of equipment or enclosure within which a nominal voltage exceeding 230 volts to earth exists, and where the presence of such a voltage would not normally be expected, shall be so arranged that before access is gained to a live part, a warning notice of the maximum voltage to earth present is clearly visible. So that point about the voltage exceeding 230 volts and the one that speaks of voltages being in unexpected places are particularly relevant. Even more relevant is the next regulation that says, a warning notice of such durable material as to be likely to remain easily legible throughout the life of the installation shall be fixed in each position where there are live parts which are not capable of being isolated by a single device. The location of each disconnector or isolator shall be indicated unless there is no possibility of confusion. If we also jump to paragraph 537.1.2, the requirement for warning notices is also reinforced. Where an installation or an item of equipment or enclosure contains live parts connected to more than one supply, A durable warning notice shall be placed in such a position that any person, before gaining access to live parts, will be warned of the need to isolate those parts from the various supplies unless an interlocking arrangement is provided to isolate all the circuits concerned. So clearly the regs are indicating, unless some form of contactor is used at the distribution board to isolate both circuits simultaneously, that it is not just best practice, but it is essential to put a warning notice located on the box to let the person doing work know that multiple supplies require isolation, the maximum voltage is present, and the location of each isolator so as to avoid danger from electric shock. As to actual prevention of danger, this then becomes the responsibility of the competent person doing the work heeding those warning notices and will pretty much come down to the basic fundamentals of electrical safety and following the correct safe isolation procedure in order to prevent such danger. The definition of isolation in BS 7671 specifically mentions more than one source of electrical energy. A method of identifying these circuits and locations for switching off every source of electrical energy have now been established, but also, importantly, a means of locking off each isolating device to avoid inadvertent re-energising of either of the circuits whilst the work is being carried out is required. It should also go without saying that the replacement of one of the socket outlets in the Varibox does not have to be done live and that it is more than reasonably practicable to be made dead before carrying out this work. One final but important note, in line with paragraph 196 of EAWR 1989, is that all conductors for all circuits must be proved dead before starting work using an approved voltage indicator to GS38, proved and reproved before and after testing for dead. So there we have it. There is in fact nothing in BS 7671 that prohibits the installation of multiple circuits within a single accessory or enclosure, providing that all circuits within remain electrically separate, suitable warning notices are in place, and that the correct safe isolation precautions are taken in line with the Electricity at Work regulations of 1989. For more information on safe isolation, check out our free training package by clicking the link in the description below. And if you've enjoyed this video, then please check out this one right here. All that remains in this video is to say thank you very much for watching.